Second reading is taken from Luke chapter 14, verse 1 and 7 to 15. On one occasion, when Jesus was going to the house of the leader of the Pharisees to eat a meal on the Sabbath, they were watching him closely. When he noticed how the guests chose the places of honor, he told them a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honour, in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who invited both of you may come to say to you, give this person your place. And then, in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up higher. Then you will be honoured in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He said also to the one who had invited him, when you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbours, in case they may invite you in return, and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. One of the dinner guests, on hearing this, said to him, blessed is anyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God.
Pharisees and lawyers. Any lawyers present? Just be careful. I just need to know if I need to be careful or not. First there'd be food, and then drink, and then there would be a formal philosophical conversation, with everyone taking a turn speaking. I actually once went to a party at a Somali home, and after the meal, the men, all in a separate room, sat around and talked. But the rules were really very clear. One person would speak maybe for 10, 15 minutes, then the next person would speak, then the next person would speak, and no one would interrupt. No one would interrupt, they just talked. And that was the way the conversation went, and you could see that that was the way it was done. And I guess the dinner, the party that Jesus was at, would be rather similar to that. These might have been the rules for the Pharisees and lawyers at the party Jesus was attending. And sometimes there would be a special guest who would be invited to listen for what he had to say. And that special guest ought to have been listened to politely. And Jesus, being neither a Pharisee nor a lawyer, but a controversial speaker, the preacher would have been the guest speaker at the party. But the gospel shows that this was not exactly a friendly group. And Jesus had been invited under scrutiny. His mini TED talk that he gave is kind of challenging to his host. People were hypocritically showing off and ensuring they were in the best seats. Then the gospel says Jesus tells a parable. What follows doesn't sound like a parable. He gives some teaching, some advice, and maybe a bit of a rebuke. Don't put yourself in the prime spot in case someone asks you to take a lesser seat if someone more important than you turns up. And then if they don't, you look good when you're asked to sit in a more prominent position. That would be very useful advice for us today as well. And then he gives an even harsher bit of advice to his host. Don't invite your friends who will pay you back with a reciprocal invite or a nice bottle of wine. Now invite those who can't pay you back. Invite those who can't pay. Then he says, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. Jesus is being very provocative. He isn't making a charity appeal at the end of the talk. I've been to those kind of parties as well. He's confronting his well-versed hearers with some home truths. I love the Bible, but there are some pretty nasty pieces in it. And one really unpleasant bit of Leviticus, it's always Leviticus, isn't it? Some reason or another. It talks about the purity of the priesthood. No one who has a disability, whether they're crippled, lame, or blind, it says, could come near to the altar in the temple. And so they were excluded from the temple. They were excluded from the priesthood. They were excluded because they were not able to access God. And the gospel uses the word poor to describe everyone who is in some way marginalized or excluded from society, whether that be financial exclusion or social exclusion. So when Jesus tells his host to invite the poor, the crippled, lame and the blind, he's making a direct challenge to the rules of society, a direct challenge to the law upheld by the lawyers in the room. He's saying, rethink your values. And more than that, he's saying, reframe law. Rethink who is in and who is out, who belongs, who matters. Jesus is shaming guests at their Sabbath lunch because they are honoring only themselves and not everyone who needs to be respected. The Bible says that Jesus is talking in parables because this little anecdote is a metaphor for all time. In every society, including our own, there are people who are in and people who are not. The Office of National Statistics just announced a survey which bewilders me, and saying that since records began, the British have never been happier, more satisfied with their lives, and more likely to think that their lives are worthwhile. Anxiety is down too. And this is evidence against doom-mongers. It feels that we're living in the same sort of party that Jesus attended. self-satisfied, comfortable group of people sitting around a table, talking philosophy, confident with their lives, while others are excluded, abused, mistreated, unnoticed, unheard. Their statistic is lost. It isn't an image of a cohesive society, and Jesus is right to call it out. And this is the contrast between the rules of this world and the rule of God. In the rule of God, there is no exclusion based on who you are or how you are different. Difference is not a shame, but a blessing. We are blessed when we give to others, when we ally ourselves with others who stand apart from the mainstream. Now, these are very challenging days for the United Kingdom. The decision made at the referendum 3 years ago to leave the European Union has landed us in a full-blown constitutional mess. A democratic framework based on precedents, rituals and conventions appears to have provided cohesion in the past, but it has been dependent upon honesty and trust and keeping the rules. Current events show that it has been weighed in the balance and found wanting. Our democracy is not a given. It has been bequeathed, not a given, it has been bequeathed to us by past generations who struggled at great cost to ensure that all had a stake in the country. And whilst we must be very, very cautious about making comparisons with the 1930s, there are real dangers in the approach of this new administration. We must be exceptionally vigilant in the weeks and months ahead. For the slippery slope is one which leads to exclusion. Exclusion for our representatives having a say on our behalf. Exclusion from the voting register. Exclusion from citizenship. Exclusion from human rights and health care. These are step-by-step incremental changes. And the danger is that we don't notice each one happening when it happens. The invitation of Jesus is to be in a feast with the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. The significance of these people is that they were deemed to be unfit to be in God's presence. Jesus is saying that the opposite is true. Those outside the camp have pride of place in the kingdom of God. This is the feast. When we come to communion, the barriers are broken down and we are one in Christ. Blessed, says Jesus, is anyone who eats bread in the kingdom of God. The table we have here is also a parable. Coming to this table is a statement that another world is possible. It is a metaphor that all are welcome to share in the abundance of the resources that God has given us. In the Eucharist, we meet with God through our fellowship with one another and our open invitation to all to participate with us. Church has created all kinds of rules about the sacrament. It has made decisions about who can and who cannot eat the bread and drink wine with us. There are none. The sacrament is an ordinance of grace. To eat and drink together is to open our hearts to Christ, our host and our guest. This is a foretaste, an anticipation, a dream of a world come. To be served in communion is to be willing to serve. To be open in communion is to be responsive to all in need. To eat bread and drink wine is to dream of and to work for transformation in society, because God knows we need it. Let's pray. give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to keep the rules, to labour and not to ask for any reward, save that of knowing that we do thy will. To bring our prayers to God. We pray for our country, for the preservation of hard-fought freedoms and rights, for the integrity of our decision-making, and the decision makers, the responsibility we all share to understand and to act to common good. We pray forgiveness and urge repentance from those who abuse power and privilege. Pray for the world, for those who tirelessly seek to protect the environment, for those who seek to create peace and reconciliation, for those who inspire a vision of a world in which Earth's resources are equitably shared and sustainably harvested, for those who work full participation in democracy in countries where it is denied, especially thinking about the people of Hong Kong today. We pray for forgiveness and urge repentance for those who light fires and pollute land and sea for personal profit and gain, and for those who use violence clamp down on those who seek their rights. We pray for our communities, for people who are excluded from participation because of their identity, ability or status, for those at the receiving end of hatred and violence, for those who face illness and bereavement. We pray for and urge repentance from those who perpetuate hatred, prejudice, and discrimination. We pray for ourselves as we prepare to receive the Blessed Sacrament, the Body and Blood of Jesus Christ. May this sharing be for us a sign of our commitment to the rule of God, the alternative way in which Jesus has taught us. May this community heal. Always be a community open to all, a place of healing, and a space where God's grace is manifest. Teach us, good Lord, to do as thou desires, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the rules, to labour and not to ask for any reward, save that of knowing. Amen. So we sing, I come with joy, the child of God, and during this evening we'll take an offertory. something a little bit different. We're going to share the peace, first of all, and then before we, after we share the peace, if you would just come and sit on the front row, and if the front row fills out, sit on the third row. And then we feel closer together to each other as we receive the bread and wine. And go back afterwards. Okay? Or you can stay with that. You do it back afterwards. But if you don't mind, we share the peace and then we come first row, third row. I think you'll fit in. Peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer one another a sign.
Body and blood of our beloved Jesus Christ,
in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, blessed it, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, all of you, take and eat, for this is my body which was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In like manner after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, all of you, drink of this, for this is my blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. We receive these precious symbols of your life given to us in love, the bread of life everlasting, the cup of liberation. We open ourselves to you and your grace. We offer ourselves, our souls and our bodies to be a living sacrament in the power of God. And as we eat and drink this wine, may we receive spiritual blessings and draw ever closer to the one who gave his life for all humanity, through whom, in whom, and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, forever and ever. Amen. And we pray together the prayer of Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation. Breaking this bread, we are one with each of you and our brothers and sisters in faith. Christ is broken on the altar of the Lord. We and all humanity be restored. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Come, all is prepared. visitors to bring us home. Jesus Christ, you saw us in our need and came to greet us to share our hope. Holy Spirit, you saw our hunger and came to feed us with spiritual food. May we go out from this place in the power of the three to bring life to others. Thursday evening at 7 we have our community creation group, which is a small group. Everybody's welcome to join, looking at how the church can respond to issues of ecology and climate change. And then, big notice, on the 15th of September we have our welcome service for Daisy Ann and reception of you and members into church. So that's a special service followed by a barbecue. Right, so let's sing our closing hymn, great hymn, based on words by St. Augustine. Light of the minds that know. Go back to places. Stay where you are. Whatever you feel like. Light of the minds that know.
Thank you.
May he bring you home rejoicing all the wonders he has shown. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. And the blessing of the God of love, the Saviour of the downtrodden, and the empowering Holy Spirit be with us all this week and forevermore.